Mutual aid alone is not going to get us to revolution. Mutual aid can and will play a role in revolutionary strategy, but mutual aid alone is not going to get us to revolution. Revolution is an act in which one class overthrows another and seizes control over society. This requires strategy. Who ultimately makes revolution? The masses. How can the masses be transformed into a revolutionary force? By waging combative mass struggle under proletarian revolutionary leadership. By having their consciousness transformed through combative mass work. Emphasis on combative. Revolution is a fight, and this fight can only be won if large sections of the masses participate. This fight can only be won if they're trained to win this fight. That's the broad assessment. What that looks like and what forms that takes depends on local conditions, which you can only find out by engaging in social investigation. So then where does mutual aid come in? I sat down with a comrade from FTP Boston to ask them this exact question. They've written an amazing article on this subject called One Step Forward, Two Steps Back, which you can find in the description. Let's go ahead and break down their criticisms of mutual aid step by step.
Broadly, the approach to mutual aid that is dominant is that there is something to serving the people, which is like in and of itself strategically worthwhile. And I think that it's just kind of metaphysics, like that has nothing to do with the actual strategic question of like, how do we build up organizations capable of struggling to conquer political power? Ultimately, what mutual aid work is doing is just making people more comfortable under capitalism. What mutual aid work is doing, particularly what it's accomplishing, is the role of the state, which is the reproduction of existing social relations.
In imperialist capitalist nations, workers supposedly make enough money to be able to reproduce themselves, meaning enough money for food, shelter, you know, just the basics of the basics. Wherever capitalists fall short of doing this, the state steps in to provide the rest. Whenever the state fails to do this, a social crisis emerges, and people start thinking, hey, I guess the ruling class ain't all that. In the eyes of the masses, their legitimacy starts being affected. With the situation being worse, meaning contradictions are heightened, it's easier to organize and mobilize people for revolution, to educate them to make the leap from reformist consciousness to revolutionary consciousness. But if all you're focusing on is mutual aid, then there's no way for that leap to occur. If people are hungry because neither the state nor the capitalist helps them out, and you give them a plate of food, then you've just solved the bourgeoisie's problem for them. This is not to say it's bad to give someone hungry food. I shouldn't have to explain myself that this is still a good thing to do, but it's not revolutionary in and of itself. Alright, you say. That's a complete misrepresentation of mutual aid, you say. Our mutual aid work is done in combination with propaganda. We got zines, leaflets, books, you know.
In a lot of these left milieus, that work of like feeding people or getting people groceries or like, I don't know, helping people like build their community garden or whatever, it like, in order to quote unquote politicize it, and that's the word that keeps coming up in these spaces, the mutual aid work is accompanied by political education. Whether it's like giving out zines or like carrying out study sessions or whatever, the goal is, okay, we're using this mutual aid to build connections with people, and then we're leveraging those connections in order to like develop their political consciousness by teaching them about Marx or Lenin or Mao or whatever. And that's like fine, but not actually political organizing is ultimately the sort of conclusion that we draw.
Why is this not actual political organizing? Let's break this down. Organizing the masses for struggle means using social investigation to determine what problems are the most pressing and then organize around that struggle. This struggle should have demands, and preferably a class enemy you can make those demands to. Of course, you shouldn't bite off more you can chew. You have to build up capacity and build up organization in order to do this. But each step you take should be towards this goal. People under capitalism are conditioned to only think about their immediate problems and concerns like, how am I gonna pay my rent? Capitalist education makes sure that you don't seek out the why, but accept the facts as they are. This doesn't mean the masses are mindless sheep only thinking about food, shelter, and sex. But even our quest for meaning and self-actualization are shaped to serve the reproduction of capitalism. Everything we do is in service to keep this damn system going. You want meaning in life? Oh, go ahead. You can find it in the commodity. People tend to take interest in things that affect them directly or are connected to things they already know about. Knowledge expands like building blocks. We can only build on what's already there, and blocks can't hover in air without a foundation. So if you shove a Mao pamphlet in someone's hands and expect them to grasp the science of revolution on their own, that's like someone handing you a pamphlet on astrophysics and wonder why the masses haven't figured out how to live on Mars yet. There's nothing there that connects to their direct experience, at least at first glance. What does? Their direct struggles. And it's while struggling alongside of them, making the demands with them, celebrating victories, or agitating around defeats with them that you can connect this to larger revolutionary ideas. And once those blocks are placed, handing them text by Mao will all of a sudden make a lot more sense.
The people who are going to linger, or the people who are going to actually be attracted to that, are by and large intermediate elements, by and large activist elements, and this is something that we've seen in our experience, that the sort of work that we've done doing this long-term and really logistically intense mutual aid organizing has been to attract more intermediates, more activist types, and then do some political education among those activist types, but not actually organizing the masses for struggle. That in fact, rather than organizing the masses for struggle, what it's doing is sort of the opposite.
If you're focusing all your organizing time and logistical energy on providing food, then you're doing the opposite of organizing people for struggle. You're divesting your time and energy from where it needs to go. The comrade from FTP Boston uses their own experience to drive home this point.
And in particular, the sort of struggle to do this in the context of COVID-19, and particularly in these sort of early days of COVID-19, where you had this massive wave of labor struggle across the country, was just the absolute wrong strategic outlook. That rather than doing this, we could have been dedicating our energy to organizing amongst, for example, the like so-called essential workers. And while like a lot of that organizing and a lot of the sort of movement that emerged and then fizzled out of that was controlled by the like bureaucrat revisionist trade unions, there was a lot of potential for organizing that got wasted because of these attempts at instead doing like mutual aid work and things like that.
All right. There's no way we can make revolution without building up the capacity for combativity. But how can you make revolution with someone who won't even trust you enough to watch their kid? This is a valid point. If you're not organizing in a neighborhood you're from, you're dealing with a lot of extra obstacles. For one, talk to any working class person and you'll hear enough stories about how much people have promised them things. And this is people from both revolutionary and non-revolutionary organizations. The masses have a lot of distrust, and they should. So yes, you do have to make an effort to build up relationships and build up trust.
So like, again, it's not that we sort of sweepingly disapprove of mutual aid work in general, because if, for example, you're trying to do neighborhood organizing in a neighborhood, one way of developing mass contacts there might be like doing a food distro or like handing out bottles of water or something as a way to like break the ice and talk to people. And as long as that is contextualized by these other political objectives or other strategic objectives while you're doing the work, it's fine, it's great. But there's a sort of opportunity cost that needs to be measured. And when so much organizational capacity is just going towards these like serve the people projects and not towards organizing for class struggle, there is maybe a sort of problem that needs to be addressed.
This point's incredibly important. There's nothing inherently wrong with mutual aid work, just like how nothing is inherently wrong with reforms. Their usefulness is determined by their relation to revolution, by how they fit into the puzzle that is revolutionary strategy. In the end, mutual aid is a tactic, and tactics are determined by, yep, strategy. Let me give an example. Let's say you're doing social investigation in a neighborhood, but no one wants to talk to you. This, in my personal experience, has never happened to me, but fine. I'm sure neighborhoods exist where this is the case. In this instance, it might be a good idea to do a low-cost food drive just to get your foot in the door. Or maybe there's already a food drive where everybody congregates at. If all the good stuff's already happening there, it might be worthwhile to insert yourself in this space. In this case, you're doing mutual aid work in order to do social investigation. And once you're able to do social investigation, you don't necessarily need to engage in mutual aid as intensely anymore. Or you can have it be taken over by people in the neighborhood if necessary. This could also be a necessity if people are willing to talk to you but don't fully want to delve into what their problems are. There's countless of scenarios I could think of, but in the end, it's a cost-benefit thing. If you're promising massive amounts of food every week for the sake of offering food, then all of your organizing energy is going to be on fundraising, preparing the food, and making sure things go smoothly logistically every week. That's a lot of work. When are you going to have time to do social investigation and build organization? At this point, you might say, all right, all of this makes sense. But it's okay if it takes a lot of energy because we need our own institutions. All this talk about combative organization is nice, but how does this build up? And here it comes, dual power. Dual power marks a milestone in a revolutionary process where you're actually contending for power with the bourgeois state on equal terms. Not equal in terms of technology, but equal in terms of, again, power. And we all know where power flows and stems from.
Okay, well, do this serve the people work, and in so doing, try and draw the masses into doing serve the people work themselves, and doing this, we can sort of build up these, like, basically glorified community organizations, these glorified red NGOs, and this is somehow building up dual power. And the sort of Leninist notion of dual power, which is a proletarian new state capable of challenging the bourgeois class dictatorship on the political terrain, gets sort of hand-waved away and transformed into a very conciliatory or like non-combative, almost counter-revolutionary, like, vision of the political self-articulation of the masses by way of like red NGOs and red charities. And somehow by doing this work, we are also building up the party, and somehow mystically at some point in the hand-waved off future, that will transform itself into revolution. And the sort of strategic question of how to get from here to there sort of falls by the wayside.
What's the strategy for making revolution? How do you get to a point where you can contend with the state on equal terms? How does handing out food fit into the strategy? What purpose does it serve? There's no way that handing out food is a form of dual power. In that case, any time leftists get together to accomplish a goal, this could be called dual power. Anytime leftists set up anything, it could be marked as dual power. No matter what kind of organization or institution. But until we have the power to defend it, it's not. In the US alone, the left has been building up its own institutions for over a century, from cultural institutions to sports, art collectives, and schools, and any type of mass organization imaginable. But at what point has there ever been a situation we could truly call dual power? Does this mean setting up our own institutions and organizations is meaningless? No. Just that everything we do should have a purpose and a goal, and connect it to larger goals. And if you hand wave off how A is going to lead to B, then you're just grasping for air. It's the same thing with the slogan, join an organization. Okay, what organization? What for? Just because you're organizing doesn't necessarily mean you're bringing the revolution any closer. At this point, you might say, all right there, buddy, all right. Maybe mutual aid doesn't directly build up dual power on its own accord, but who doesn't want to feed the hungry? What are you, a monster?
I think it's specifically because I call myself a communist that, you know, I'm thinking about feeding the people and serving the people, and the most sort of real service that one can do to the masses is to make revolution. It's not to hand them a loaf of bread, right? Like, first of all, there's only so many people that we could feed through mutual aid work, and for every one person that we're giving a bag of groceries, there's 1,000 who aren't receiving a bag of groceries, and somewhat more importantly, by doing that, we're also just sort of prolonging the conditions of their exploitation, we're prolonging the conditions of their oppression, when in fact the goal should be to develop their sort of organizational capacity to struggle against those forces, to struggle against that exploitation. There is something of actual class struggle organizing that does the ideological work that the sort of politicization of mutual aid attempts to do and fails, that there's sort of more political education that takes place over the course of organizing for struggle, over the course of organizing and then winning a set of demands, than one can do by simply approaching someone and saying, you should be reading Lenin or you should be reading Marx. when, if we're materialists, we recognize that that kind of consciousness, that sort of like self-recognition of the proletariat or the proletariat, whatever, like that emerges over the course of class struggle. That's the basic dialectics.
Of course, it's easy to criticize, harder to offer alternatives. So if the current way that mutual aid is used is incorrect, what's the path we should take? Combative mass struggles.
So when we talk about like combative mass work, what we're referring to is mass work that attempts to organize the masses for class struggle, whether it's developing like tenant organizations or workers' organizations or women's organizations that are capable of struggling against and then ousting an abuser from a community, whether it's, you know, engaging in like mass anti-fascist struggle. When we're doing these things, what we're attempting to do is develop lasting mass organizations, people's committees, struggle committees, whatever you want to call them, that are sort of taking the initiative of mass struggle and channeling it, organizing it, and then also at the same time identifying advanced elements that are emerging over the course of those struggles and drawing them into the sort of class organization or the like pre-party or whatever you want to call it. So the goal is not to just become friends with the masses or like sort of make one's organization popular or develop an organization's prestige by like doing work or showing up at things, but to materially organize the class for struggle. And so that means going out in neighborhoods and talking to people and identifying sort of potential sites of struggle. And that's the thing that we talk about a lot, is like identifying and then organizing around a concrete site of struggle, around a concrete set of demands, whether it's a single building or an apartment complex or a neighborhood fighting against gentrification, or whether it's a specific workplace. I think there's this sort of tendency on the left to like talk about things like revolution in these very abstract terms. We need to concretize that very specifically in order to approach the work that we're doing with a like meaningful set of tactics. And it's slow. It's not sort of a thing that happens very quickly. But if we want to actually engage in a project of party building, what we have to do is go to the masses and organize the masses for struggles. Since the party is ostensibly an organization that's capable of leading struggles. Without struggle, there is no class organization. There is no party.
This sounds great, but then how do we build organization capable of combative mass struggle in the first place? It's something I emphasize over and over and over again. Any organization worth its revolutionary salt needs to arise out of line struggle and continually be tempered through line struggle.
Yeah, so I mean, I think this is sort of a point of self-criticism for us, which is our organization didn't necessarily emerge on the basis of really thorough line struggle, and this led to a lot of our sort of early errors. That was sort of why we started out by engaging in that sort of like mutual aid work, and that style of work defined our approach to politics for a really long time. It was problematic, and I think had we prioritized the sort of Maoist method of unity, struggle, unity in approaching those things, we would likely be in a better position now. The sort of tendency towards like opportunistic unity in order to just carry out these like narrow forms of practical work just for the sake of like doing the work is really politically problematic. And it's what leads to this proliferation of these like red mutual aid organizations. It leads to this sort of proliferation of like volunteerist organizing, as opposed to sort of thoroughly scientific and revolutionary attempts at developing class struggle organizations. Without revolutionary theory, there can be no revolutionary practice. Without struggle over line and method of work, without intense study, like no one comes to organizing thoroughly equipped with the sort of Marxist scientific method, or very few people do. And without sort of engaging in dialogue and engaging in struggle over like what the actual best way to approach the work is, gonna run into problems really quickly.
Of course you have line struggles within organizations, but don't forget about the movement as a whole.
What we would love to see is criticism of the documents that we put out. You know, like we have our summation. We've also released the 10 Things I Love or Hate About USA. We are putting these things forward not just to like hear ourselves speak, not just to like have something that gets circulated and is popular, but because we want criticism. We want line struggle in the movement. You know, liquidating those things is tantamount to like liquidating theoretical development. The best way to support us is to send us a long criticism of all the things that we're doing wrong, because we would love to see that.
Thank you so much to FDP Boston for discussing their important piece on mutual aid. Please let me know what you think of this position in the comments and don't hesitate reaching out to them to learn more or discuss these ideas. Their info is in the description. Big shout out to my patrons for supporting the channel and thank you for watching. Please like, subscribe, and share this video. It really helps out a lot. And don't forget to check out this video on the mass line. It goes over a lot of the concepts discussed in this video. Peace, love, and solidarity. Space, baby, out.